I feel like this is our annual gathering of real information.
It is. It takes about a year or so to get through these films. So, it's, you know, we'll catch up once a year from here on out.
And you kind of are, it's funny because people at Entertainment Weekly used to say to me, why do you talk to studio heads? Because they weren't really relevant to the actual stories they were doing, but they actually know everything. And I feel that way with you, is that I'm like talking to the guy who actually knows how this hall worked.
From the inside out, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So the machinery of this movie is, from my eye, I don't know whether I'm right or wrong, mm-hmm. it seems like you absolutely threw everything, including the kitchen sink, into this one.
Yeah, exactly. Well, you know, it starts off with a small little book, and I remember everyone saying, it's one book, how are you going to make two movies out of it? And then it turns into three, and you realize there's a lot of story there. And not only is there a lot of story, but, you know, Peter wants to make it a fun movie. So you get into these scenes, and you just keep coming up with ways to make it bigger and bigger.
So, but I mean, it feels like you actually had all the, you have certain tools in your tool chest at Weta that you use. So you, it seemed like you were using motion capture.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Had you done that before except for Gollum on those movies, or did you?
Doing motion capture on set the way we did with Gollum, we actually did with Andy for Caesar, for Rise of the Planet of the Apes. We did
so this was a reflection of that again.
Exactly, yes, yeah, yeah. We had been, you know, gearing up towards, okay, Hobbit's coming, this is what we want to do, because right. it was kind of a closure from what we did 10 years ago. Mm-hmm. But then Apes slipped in with that little script and that little story, and we said, well, this is perfect too, so let's just kick it into gear.
And was there Tintin stuff in there also that you had figured out during that process, or?
Well, what we learned from Tintin that got reflected into this was a lot of the lighting we were doing for big architectural spaces and big mm-hmm. interiors and things like that. Yeah.
And then I noticed some Avatar shots going in and through and under and around and all of that.
Exactly, a lot of the real, big camera moves and that sort of thing. Although we did a fair amount of that in Tintin as well. So yeah, we've been building up this repertoire over the years of things that we can draw on when we need them.
And does the 48 frame thing make it harder or easier, or does it change anything really in terms of your work?
All it really changes for us is you've got twice as many frames to do, you know, so it doesn't really change the work that you have to put into it. Mm-hmm. There's a little bit more hand work in some places, you know, if you're doing like a painting out a character because you've got to replace him with a digital character, mm-hmm. wire, rig removal, those sorts of things, tracking the camera so you can create a perfect virtual camera. Mm-hmm. Sure, you have twice as many frames to do. So yeah, it does add to the workload. Mm-hmm. Animation actually benefits from it because if you have any fast motion like blinks and, you know, dialogue and things like that, you can mm-hmm. fine tune it because you have more, you know, more frames to play with. Lighting doesn't really get affected at all, you know, mm-hmm. unless you're doing maybe lightning, you know, mm-hmm. otherwise, you know, lighting, you just sort of light normally. And so we actually work, you know, usually at like 24 frames a second mono anyway while we're blocking in the shot.
Right.
And then as the animation gets locked down and approved, you start refining it as the lighting and the, you know, the textures and everything are approved, then you start going to 48 for your final iteration. So you're creating twice as much for the final film, but you're not doing twice as much work the whole way through the film, or four times as much, I guess, because it's stereo, 48 frames.
So is the quote-unquote look of 48 frames a consideration as from the start to the end, or is that an additional thing later? I mean, because it does look in the first section, particularly when you're in Hobbiton and it's fairly basic stuff, mm-hmm. it does look different.
It does look different, and it's nothing that we really have to plan for, because what 48 frames comes out of this idea that when you're in stereo, your mm-hmm. eye wants to be able to focus on things in motion. The equivalent is if you talk about depth of field, right? Mm-hmm. Okay, if you're in stereo and you've got an over-the-shoulder shot and your foreground subject is out of focus, because your eye thinks you're looking at a three-dimensional space, your eye thinks, well, if I go and look at that out-of-focus head, it's going to focus mm-hmm. like your eye does in the real world. But it doesn't. It stays out of focus. It's one mm-hmm. of the differences of, you know, what we call 3D, which is really stereo viewing,
right.
as opposed to what your eye does see in the real world. Okay, so back on when we were doing Avatar, we noticed that if you had a lot of shots with fast motion, they tended to look blurry. Mm-hmm. You take off the glasses and look at it in 2D, it's what you expect. You know, if something's running across the screen really fast, it blurs mm-hmm. a little bit. It's motion blur, we're all used to it. But we figured out that when you're looking at it in stereo, your eye wants to do the same thing as it does with something out of focus. If your mm-hmm. eye focuses and tracks it across the screen, you expect it to be sharp, because that's what happens in the real world.
Mm-hmm.
But you've already photographed this thing that's a blurry image. You can't You can't unwind it.
Right.
So the answer is, if you go to a higher frame rate, then your eye can track it like it's in the real world, because in the real world, your eye's not limited by, you know, number of frames. It's infinite. So a higher frame rate gives you more of that experience of mm-hmm. just what your eye sees. If you look at a static shot, there's no difference. There's no difference in the amount of motion. It looks the same. Right. So really, the difference is perceptual. And I think you only really see it or really care about it when you're looking at stereo. If you're looking mm-hmm. at, you know, 24 frame mono image, that blur is what we're all used to. It doesn't you know, doesn't affect your perception.
So do you think the lack of the blur is disturbing to some people who are used to that blur? I mean, do you think that older eyes like my own, you know, people in their 50s and 60s and older are, you know, used to film looking a certain way when you do these things?
I do think it's a generational thing. After the premiere, my daughter, who's 14, mm-hmm. was standing around while we were all discussing it, and she said, "What are you guys talking about? I didn't notice a difference." you know, because it is what we're all used to. Remember the leap from film to digital and how jarring that was for people. Now we're all used to it. I think it's very similar. You know, yeah. Film to digital, digital to stereo, stereo to 48 frames.
Well, I think people are used to it, but resistant somehow. Like, you know, I guess the richness of the Rings history and the visual look of those movies mm-hmm. makes them kind of feel like when it looks too real, I guess, is the reality of it, because that's what it looks like. It mm-hmm. looks like you're, it almost looks at times like the images they created just to try to sell high-definition television in the early days, you mm-hmm. know, to mm-hmm. find the most beautiful, luscious thing mm-hmm. and have it look so great that you had to love the TV. Mm-hmm. I think you feel that way a lot during this movie.
Which is ironic, because we spent all of our time and effort trying to make everything we put on the screen look as real as possible, and this yeah. is just sort of one step in that direction.
So you've yeah. offended us by succeeding.
Sorry.
So are the lush greens and all of that stuff? I mean, one of the things that I felt like I hadn't seen in the other Rings movies or in the previous movies mm-hmm. was this kind of rollicking mountain greenery being so intensively green and so mm-hmm. luscious. Is mm-hmm. that just New Zealand looking that good, or are you guys fixing that?
No, that is just New Zealand looking that good. Some of the difference might be actually, you know, in what's being done with the grading of the film, because mm-hmm. a lot of times when you saw some of those landscape in Rings, the scenes were a little bit more ominous, and so mm-hmm. the grading might have been a little bit more, you know, muted to convey that feeling,
right.
Where here was a little bit more hopeful, and so, you know, the lushness and the color mm-hmm. was sort of brought to the forefront a little bit more.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So when you guys started down the road, does it kind of amble down the road and you kind of have conversations as you go? Is Pete going, okay, I want to use this tool that we had from mm-hmm. this to do this? Or is it really the same kind of, you know, here's the script, you figure it out?
Yeah, Peter's not really thinking about the tool so much. It is script, story, here's what we need to do. Uh-huh. If it's something that we know how to do, it's just, you know, fine. Here's how we'll handle it. So we let him know so he's comfortable with it, and we jump into it. A lot of it are things that we have to figure out together, like the whole forced perspective was a big one, because obviously we can come up with a lot of techniques and ways to make that happen, mm-hmm. but there are also certain things that matter when you're shooting it. It's like what can and do you want to do while you're shooting it to make it happen. So, mm-hmm. you know, in the old days, right, forced perspective, you line up, you know, Gandalf closer to the camera than Frodo, and you know, one looks bigger, one looks smaller, you're done with it. Mm-hmm. In stereo, that breaks right off the bat because you've got two perspective lines. Mm-hmm. So that no longer works, and especially once you start moving the camera, you know, it no longer works. Uh-huh. But still, there are gradations of things like that you can do, you know, where you can actually, like, put the dwarves, you know, down on their knees and Gandalf up on an apple box mm-hmm. and still get away with it as long as you're not moving the camera too much. Once you start moving the camera, we develop this really elaborate, you know, slave motion control system, we called it, where mm-hmm. Bag End was a good example where we used it, where you've got the dwarves all moving through their Bag End set. On an adjacent green screen, we have a miniature version of Bag End, but it's all green. Sir Ian acted on that green screen, tennis mm-hmm. balls all over the set, so he knew where the dwarves were. Mm-hmm. And Peter directed them both simultaneously, so the camera was being moved on the Bag End set. It was driving a motion control camera on the mm-hmm. green screen set, and, you know, everyone had choreographed their actions, and Peter would just direct it, and you'd get, you know, Gandalf stopping to talk to Bilbo and you know, walking and ducking through doorways and doing all this stuff simultaneously. It was happening mm-hmm. on both stages at the same time. So in the monitor, Peter and all, you know, all the camera operators could see a rough composite of what was going on. And then, you know, we took all that footage and put it together later, and, you know, a lot of cut and paste and paint work to fit it all back in together.
It's funny because I felt less like they were worried about that in this movie than I did in the Rings movies. Mm-hmm. Like in the Rings movies, particularly with Gandalf in the first couple early scenes, it was like they were really trying hard to make sure. I mean, he bumps into a lamp in this one, but it doesn't feel like that thing where you're like really making the point. He just kind of seems bigger.
Yeah.
And it's okay, and it's not like a focus of the film as much, I guess.
Yeah, that's exactly right. Probably because of the history. You know, people have seen it before. They know that's what to expect. Now we wanted to just work in three dimensions.
So was bringing the mountain to life the easiest thing you did?
Bringing the mountain to life?
Bringing the mountain. Bringing rocks to...
Oh, sorry, the stone giant.
The stone giant.
Sorry, I was thinking...
I had to find the right phrasing.
Sorry, when you said the mountain, I was thinking the Lonely Mountain. You know, that was hard, too, because you've got these things that are made out of stone, but they're having a battle. And
had you guys ever done anything quite like that before?
No, not really.
I mean, it seemed closest to Transformers, that kind of...
Their
work. But.
Exactly, where you have something, you know, a lot of rigid surfaces that have to move and give you this complex articulated motion. Mm-hmm. The advantage that you have with something like Transformers is you can move pieces out of the way to allow for motion.
Right.
Here we had to keep going through the motions and redesigning all the placement of the rocks so that they could slide past each other and not, you know, interfere and still get this kind of dynamic performance.
So is that one of the harder things? Is there a hardest thing on a film like this, or is there... Just everything is hard. And
yeah, everything was hard for its own reason. You know, I mean, the slave motion control stuff was actually hard because as well planned out as it is and as integrated as it is, it comes down to, you know, pixel kind of accuracy with both eyes and all the elements to make everything work together. You know, then you had, you know, like, for example, when you go into the Goblin Caverns, that whole scene was just this big three-dimensional extravaganza because you walk into it and you think about it, it's like an inverted city. You know, you go into the middle of it and the city's all around you. And that was designed deliberately so that we could explore this space and take advantage of three dimensions. You know, the camera's going not only in and out, but it's going up and down and flying everywhere. So that was a fairly, you know, complex system to build and to choreograph all those shots through. So, yeah, you name it, there was probably some trick we had to come up with to make it work.
Well, there were a lot of sequences like that sequence where you kind of, in that sequence it was, God, if Spielberg had this technology when Indiana Jones 2 was being made, you know, think of how much more he could have done than have, you know, a little, I mean, as amazing as the little cart with the little body, little, you know, dolls in it was, this thing was just kind of breathtakingly real and intimate and... It's kind of a fascinating thing.
Well, because we have the ability now to create this realistic looking whatever, you know, we can make the characters, the creatures, you know, the environment, the stuff that they're walking on, things that break, everything that surrounds you, you know, there's a way to create it. So it just becomes, where do you dip in and dip out of it? You got a bit of a live action shot for a close up, and then you pull out to another shot. And you're looking at, you know, another speaking character like the Goblin King who doesn't exist, and all around him is, you know, his minions and this whole cavern world around it. Or the dwarves might be battling, you know, a bunch of goblins who we shot with guys kind of with, you know, costumes on, who, you know, the intention was they're going to replace their heads. We wound up just replacing all of them so we could get these weird, you know, twisted goblin bodies and not be confined to what the guys in the suit look like. So yeah, it's, you know, every time you get a shot, you look at it and say, well, what can we do to just pack it in with what we need to fill out the story?
So what is that morning like? When you come into the office, you look at the goblins and you go, you know, I think we should just replace their entire bodies. Is that something that you guys just are sitting in an office and looking at footage and going, you know, that's not good enough. Let's make ourselves really crazy.
It's actually not making yourself crazy. Sometimes it's actually easier to do that these days. The tools have gotten so flexible and easy to work with that you look at this and you think, I've got a dozen guys here who are, you know, jumping all over our dwarves, and I've got to rotoscope them and rotoscope their hair and match all this and lock the butt. Let's just replace it. It's just easier. You know?
So that's where we got it, is where it's just starting from scratch.
Yeah.
So could you have done it without the dwarves?
Well, I mean, there are times when the dwarves are digital doubles as well, for that very reason. You're doing something really complicated. You need to extend it. It's just not going to work, you know, with what's there. So we just use digital doubles. Yeah.
So is there a technology on this one? I mean, I feel like each time we have this conversation, there's another thing... Another new trick that just nobody's ever done before. Is there such a thing on this movie? Is there a new a new technology, a new direction you guys have gone that you that we haven't seen before?
Yeah, I don't know that I could pin it to one specific one because this is across the board. There's something new, you know, really across the board. If you had to say something that personally I've not, you know, used before, it would be the slave motion control, the simultaneous motion capture, for example, how we did the trolls. Because we did something like this similar on Avatar, right, where we motion captured the performance of the actors and then we fed it into the camera monitors, you know, at playback so that the camera operators live could see, you know, the Na'vi in the shot. Mm-hmm. We had discussed actually Jim directing both of them live, but it turned out that it wasn't necessary for the scenes that we did because of the way they were choreographed. Mm-hmm. But on this film, we did do that for the trolls. When the dwarves were in the troll shot set, they just had a couple of tennis balls up on sticks. They knew generally about how high to look, but they were static. Right next to the stage, we built a motion capture volume, and we had the troll performers in mocap suits with head rigs, and we just tracked the virtual camera, and again, that was put into the monitor so Peter could see what was going on and direct it, and he could see a quick composite of the two together and direct the whole thing. So that's very similar then to what we did with the green screen with Sir Ian that I was explaining earlier, except instead of a motion capture stage, that was two live action stages being done the same way. So those are things that were, as far as I know, totally new and unique for The Hobbit.
And just in this case, evolutionary more than revolutionary. That's not like the great new idea. It's really the next step in the idea you already had.
All these things are really the next step. If you look back over the last, you know, 10 years from when we did The Lord of the Rings, you can trace the evolution of all of them. So yeah, it depends on, you know, how big of a leap you perceive that to be, whether it's evolutionary or revolutionary, but the goal had been sort of building to, you know, doing this kind of filmmaking anyway, just knocking down all the barriers.
Well, like in Avatar, I felt like the story wasn't the 3D, which everybody was obsessing on, but was really that camera, the idea of the virtual camera, which I thought, you know, this is a revolutionary. This is really going to like change how people make movies, period. And I think it has already. People are starting to really get more out of it.
Exactly. No, it really has, because what Jim set out to do with Avatar was to break down the barrier between live action and virtual filmmaking, and that's, you know, where he was successful with Avatar, and that really shows itself on Hobbit. Like I said, we could set up a performance capture stage right next to the live action stage. We can mix the two together. We could do the performance capture ahead of time. We could do it later. It really didn't matter. We could be completely flexible to whatever the shot required and whatever the production required.
So is there any idea that didn't work? You kind of went into it and go, this is just, we just can't do this. We can't figure it out.
No, not really. You never get to do that, David. You never get to say, gee, this isn't going to work. It's like...
Well, you must have 20 years, you know, I think 30 years ago, somebody must have been saying that and going, you know, well, we can't do that. We can do this version of it. We can do this variation of it.
Yeah, maybe. That seems like a long time ago, though.
Yeah. Well, it's funny because you think about Spielberg putting faces on those kids in Jurassic, and it was such a revolutionary moment and the world was going to change.
That was one shot.
Yeah. But I mean... That now seems like child's play.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
You know, even the dinosaurs themselves.
There's a lot of that in this film that you know, hopefully don't know that that's what's going on.
But, and is that really your goal, is to not be noticed?
My goal actually is to create things that people are going to just say, wow, you know, I really enjoyed that whole experience. And sometimes it means you just have to do things where they don't notice it, because that's not the point. Sometimes, you know, it is the point. Sometimes when you're creating a character like Gollum, it's like, we're not trying to hide anything here. We want to create something you've never seen before.
Right. You know? So speaking of him, what is different? Why is this Gollum different than all the other Gollums? He does seem to be like another step in the evolution. He looks so much like Andy in a thin suit or something. He didn't eat for a year. More so than the other movie. I mean, it looks great in the other movies, but this is like, seems different.
Yeah, he is completely different, and yet he's the same. You know, we talked about this as 60 years earlier. Should he be younger? You know, what should he look like? So we dusted off the old model. We gave him more hair. We gave him more teeth. None of that worked. It just didn't look like him anymore. So we just said, nope, he's going back to the way he was. The only thing is we took off the scars from, you know, on his back, because that obviously happens after this. But everything that we've learned about making characters in the last 10 years has now, you know, gone into him. The face is extremely more detailed than we could ever do 10 years ago. Mm-hmm. Same thing with the eyes. His eyes have as much detail as his whole face did back on Rings. Mm-hmm. The skin, you know, subsurface scattering, that was the very first time we'd even created that effect for Gollum. Mm-hmm. And it worked. It was fairly convincing. But mm-hmm. now we understand a lot more about how to preserve detail. So you notice his skin feels thinner and a little bit more papery than it did before. Mm-hmm. Muscles, the way we used to do them was really just a big cheat in those days. Now we're actually doing proper biomechanical studies of muscles, and everything mm-hmm. is really being simulated physically correctly. So you can actually see the muscles moving under the skin and the tissue, you know, rolling against the muscles in a way that never worked before. His mm-hmm. bones are now, you know, before they used to be really simple, like here, there's sort of a bone here. Now he's got a full skeleton. I mean, all these things really add up to a physicality that when you see him perform, mm-hmm. it just looks much more real than anything that we could have done 10 years ago. And the amount of detail going into his face is now just really extreme on what was ever possible before. The way we're simulating the idea of the muscles moving under the face and the micro dynamics of the skin tissue, you know, as your face talks and speaks, and everything is just fully detailed, fully articulated mm-hmm. as much as we know how to do.
Well, it's funny because when Gollum happened, there was the conversation about whether Andy should get nominated for acting, and you know, it blew people away. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, Apes happened a couple years ago, and that blew people away. Mm-hmm. And now this is, for me, I mean, each time I thought, okay, this should be considered, this is a real thing. Mm-hmm. And this time I'm looking at it going, that really feels like Andy. Mm-hmm. It really doesn't feel like he's been, you know, put in a machine and had this fixed, that fixed, whatever. Mm-hmm. I mean, obviously, Andy doesn't look like that, thank God for Andy. Yeah. But he really does on some level. I mean, yeah, yeah. Like, it feels more like a person I've met mm-hmm. Than ever before. It's just shocking. Yeah. And then you think, well, maybe that's the moment where people go, okay, it's now an actor's performance and not a digital performance. Mm-hmm. One hopes.
I hope so, but yeah, you never know.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. But no, I mean, you can tell it is all performance. That was the very first scene we did. It was like the best way to come back to Middle Earth, you know? Mm-hmm. We're just on stage. We rigged Andy up with a performance capture suit, you know, got his facial head rig on so we can, you know, capture his facial performance. All things that we couldn't do 10 years ago that mm-hmm. we were, you know, at the time we were saying, gee, wouldn't it be great if we could only do this? You know, put cameras all around the stage with, you know, 10 years ago, you know, no producer would have let you put motion capture camera stage, you know, cameras all around a live action stage. But, mm-hmm. you know, now it's got to the point where it's accepted as part of the production process. So mm-hmm. technically we're all set up. You know, Andy and Martin walk on the stage with Peter, and it's just the two of them doing the scene. And it was, like I said, it was the first thing that we shot, and it was just brilliant.
Yeah. So when you have an organization like Weta, and you are, you know, this is an ongoing thing, but you also obviously doing other projects, there's all kinds of stuff going on. Is there a skin group that is just constantly thinking, how do I make the skin more translucent? How do I do that? Or is it the next project comes up that has this particular demand and, okay, now we're focused on it for this year and a half? Or
typically we're focused on these things across the board, because one of the legacies of Avatar is we could get called on to make anything. You know, anywhere you point the camera, there's something in the world that you might have to make. So mm-hmm. yeah, we're constantly looking at how do you make characters look and perform better, just from the performance capture point of view, but also from the performance point of view itself, because once you capture it, you still have to do the translation. There's still animation that has to go into all this. Our animation team is constantly refining techniques. As you say, skin, you know, muscles, eyes, hair, cloth, costumes, clouds, landscapes, rocks, trees, anything that you can point a camera at in the real world and photograph, we know that we might have to do a version of it that either looks real or needs to be fantastic but still looks real.
And are there people specifically who are, that this is the, you know, kind of genius of skin, or this is the genius of eyeballs, or, you know, who's really the person who knows more than anybody else in the world about that particular thing?
It's a group, because everyone has certain, you know, aspects of even that problem to look into. Because, you know, take skin, for example, you've got the subsurface scattering, you've got the light transport. That's one aspect of it. But then you also have the movements, the dynamics of it. And then you also have the textural details. So there's, you know, at least three or four people looking at any one particular problem.
Mm. Yep. So is there a best version of this movie? Of the, I guess there, what, four different ways of seeing it, at least. Mm-hmm. Is there a one that is particularly better, or is it just that they're all different?
Well, the most pristine version is going to be seeing it 48 frames in stereo. That's mm-hmm. that's all the information that we can possibly record and put into a film, and that your eyes, you know, can receive. You know, plus add the Dolby Atmos onto that if you really want to add everything that your ears can perceive, and then mm-hmm. you've got everything. But I think you'll still
see it in D-Box, and you can be knocking yeah. around through the whole thing.
I might have to draw the line here.
Maybe too much.
Yeah,
okay.
Exactly. Yeah.
Sense around, not yet.
Okay. For me, that might be a little bit too much. Exactly. But you know, any version of the film that you see it in will still play. I mean, we looked at a 24 frames, you know, just mono film projection, and it still looks good. It still feels, you know, like The Hobbit. Still feels like a Lord of the Rings film. So so it scales the whole way up. It really just depends, you know, on your appetite as an audience member for how much detail do you want to experience as you watch this film.
I do think that's the thing now, is that people have to kind of decide what experience they want to have. Because they're, mm-hmm. I mean, certainly with Avatar, you know, personally, for my personal taste, I actually enjoyed the 2D version almost more than I mean, the first experience of it in 3D was stunning and mm-hmm. breathtaking. But I went to go see the 2D and five or six I saw finally. Mm-hmm. But I really loved the 2D version, and it felt more like a traditional movie. It didn't feel like, you know, mm-hmm. you were being taken somewhere.
Yeah, we try to make sure that the experience of the movie works at all levels. So, you know, when we're working on the 48-frame stereo version, we're not sacrificing anything if you were to go see it in 2D digital projection, 24, or film, or, mm-hmm. you know, whatever your choice is, it works the whole way up and down the line.
And does delivering all those different formats mean much to you and your job, or is that...
No, for us it doesn't, because we deliver everything at 48 frame stereo, mm-hmm. but we've worked with Park Road Post, who handles all the post-production on the film, to know how to just extract the various versions and the different grading levels that are needed to optimize, you know, the different stereo viewing formats and light levels and so forth. So mm-hmm. it's something that we are kind of all involved with, right. you know, obviously, especially including Peter, to work out what those things need to be. But it's a pretty smooth process once it gets underway.
And when you're done with a film like this, do you feel, I mean, obviously you're here doing press and things like that, but I mean, do you feel pretty much done? Are you, obviously it's nice to go to a premiere and have people applaud and laugh and scream and do all the things they want to do, but mm-hmm. do you connect to that in the same way as, say, a filmmaker like Peter or Fran or Phil or whomever is, you know, in that area of it? Is mm-hmm. it the same for you? Are you looking for that moment, those jolts? Those...
Yeah, absolutely. Because, you know, in the end, we all make these films, and I'll include Peter and Fran and Philip in that, because these are the movies we want to see, you know? So we get a chance to make them and sit down and watch them. In a way, that's the big reward, you mm-hmm. know? And then it's on to the next one. So in this case, they're the next two.
And for you, is it the same as when you were 25? I mean, does it feel, do you still have that kind of excitement, the pulse going up and all that? I mean, it changes for everybody usually.
Yeah, no, I do. I've learned after doing this long enough to, you know, you get your chance to put in everything you want for the film, and when it's done and you're delivered and you're going to the premiere, you're not changing anything anyway, so you might as well just go back and, you know, sit back and enjoy it. You know, it used to be where the first time around I was still seeing, you know, the things that I wish that we could have done differently, and then the second time around I can enjoy it. Now I can pretty much just watch it the first time.
Would you have any interest in going back to King Kong? We were talking about George Lucas earlier, mm-hmm. you know, and how he's gone back to these films, and that, you know, times have changed, and he wants a fresh coat of paint. Mm-hmm. You know, some people feel it's their earlier movie or whatever, but mm-hmm. he wants it to look the best it can look. I mean, do you have the urge to go back and fix things in King Kong, or is that just a thing of its time and we did that work then and that's it?
I think it's a thing of its time. I mean, you know, if you look at the original Star Wars, the technology was so different, and now you start having, you know, digital releases and DVDs and Blu-rays or so forth, mm-hmm. that I understand why he'd want to go back in and say, okay, we have to bring this up to date because those flaws really showed. Mm-hmm. But, you know, with the advent of digital technology, you know, we've really sort of tried to make these things as forward-thinking as possible. I remember thinking that working back on Jurassic Park, thinking, God, you know we don't quite know how to do this, but we still hope it holds up in 10 years, you know. Mm-hmm. But by the time we've gotten around to doing, you know, Lord of the Rings or King Kong, I mean, Lord of the Rings is a good example. I can still go back and watch Gollum 10 years ago and think, yeah, he's still Gollum in that film, mm-hmm. even though you see him now, and like I said, he's completely different. You know, where there's so many things we can do better and make him much more vivid, much more mm-hmm. alive. But I don't have an urge to go back and say just replace him, because it starts you thinking about all these other aspects. It ripples out from any change that you make. And I'm happy to just say, that was Lord of the Rings, now this is The Hobbit.